Hello, I'm Crystal Seitz of the Greater Reading Convention and Visitors Bureau, and I'm here with my co-chair, Kevin Barnhardt, one of our county commissioners, but known as Kevin on this program.
That's right.
Welcome to Around Berks County. We're here, we have some great things to talk about today, but first let me say happy Halloween. It's coming up and sooner than we think.
Absolutely. Yeah, the whole month, actually, is Halloween month.
Is it?
That's
right. Okay, I didn't know that.
Designated by the Board of County Commissioners.
That's great. Well, thank you for that, because I know we have a lot of great things to share with you about this month and the beginning of November that are happening around the Halloween spirit and time. But I also want to say hello to my guests while we're at it. I have John Rausch of Old Belleman's Church in Mohrsville, Pennsylvania, sitting directly to my left. And then I have Dan Schaffer, who is part of the Ghost Haunted Lantern Tours, and just the Lantern Tours, at Crystal Cave up in Kutztown, Pennsylvania. Yeah, so welcome, both of you. Thank you for joining us. I thought we'll maybe start a little bit first. Maybe we'll go into Old Belleman's Church a little bit and talk to you, John, about that National Historic Site and what's happening there in the next couple weeks, but also maybe a little bit about the history.
Well, the history is that it was dedicated in 1815, so in 2 years we're going to have the 200th anniversary of the building of the church. And
that is amazing.
200 years, yeah, and it's as it was built. There's no heat, no electric, no plumbing. That's the way I always advertise. And I always put nearby. So we got some calls already. What do you mean by nearby? I think they think there's an outhouse there.
So let me ask, if I come to a service there or an event, it's cold. I should dress warm.
Right. We normally don't have services. Normally the church, we don't have anything regularly scheduled from the end of October through the end of March.
Mm-hmm. We have for services, obvious reasons.
We have a number of regular services there. This year we're in conjunction with our annual church bazaar. On the 1st and 2nd of November, we're going to have tours of the old church, in which, I don't know if you have a picture of the fact that it is listed on the National Register of Historic Places.
Maybe we can get that picture up to see.
In looking at that, that's one thing. And also the fact that it was placed there in 1973, as you can see that, which is not an easy thing to do. I was a little involved in that, not a major factor, but it did... took a major effort to get it listed, because it is as it was built. Right now we're attempting to get it painted on the outside. That's a chore because the woodwork in some cases is rather intricate. In looking at the church, you have a picture of that also. You can show the picture of that as it looks from the outside. We're going to discuss the architecture in those tours. And the tours are going to be on the 1st at 11 a.m. and at 4:30, and then on the 2nd, the tour is going to be at 11 o'clock, and we're going to have an organ concert. And as you look at the organ, which you have a picture of, it's a bowler organ. It was not in the church originally. We don't know how it, what was there before that, but that bowler was a Reading organ builder somewhere in the 1860s, 1870s.
Wow.
It's a hand pump, single manual pipe organ, and it works. There's no doubt about it. It takes very little maintenance. It's in a building that's unheated, and most times we come in spring, and away we go. It's ready to go. There's nothing that we have to do to it.
So it doesn't have ill effects from the coolness?
The coolness, I think it must be the fact that it's a constant temperature, possibly.
Okay.
You know. It does get warmer in there in the wintertime when the sun's shining in through the windows, but it doesn't really affect it that much. And as I said, with the church bazaar, we have, which is nearby, that's where the plumbing is also, if you want to use the plumbing when you visit the church. But at 11 o'clock in the morning and 4:30 in the afternoon on Friday the 1st, and on the 2nd at 11 o'clock we're going to have an organ concert just on that particular Saturday. The bazaar features all kinds of things, from a huge flea market, and Belleman's Church is located in rural, the suburbs of Mohrsville.
So explain, maybe you can give us a little bit of a direction.
Well, the best way to get there probably is if you're heading north on Route 61, go through Leesport. And the first light after you get through Leesport is Belleman's Church Road. Just hang a left on the Belleman's Church Road, and you'll wind your way there.
Gotcha.
Because Belleman's Church Road does wind quite a bit as you look at that.
Right.
Be
right.
careful.
Yeah.
Be careful, yeah. And we have anything and everything available, from breakfast. We start at 8:30 both days with the bazaar. Breakfast is available, and there's homemade candy, homemade cookies, homemade pies, homemade cakes. all kinds of homemade goodies, and as I said before, a rather large flea market if you need some fleas to take home for the winter.
Oh, is that how that works? So let me ask you, like with the church itself and all the work that's done there, mm-hmm. and is that all done by volunteers? Do you have a volunteer organization that does
basically
that kind
the church?
Of work?
The church basically there is a what we call the new church, which was dedicated in 1924. It's part of that same property. There is a committee. There's also basically, in other words, some of the painting is we need professionals for some of that because it's taking some woodworking repair and things of that particular nature.
There's always something that has to be done.
Oh yeah, yeah. There's always
every
something.
Every year, there's always something.
Always something. We also have an old cemetery where the oldest birth was 1709 in Germany. That he's buried there in that particular case, and we have a number of Revolutionary War up into the Spanish American War buried there.
Wow!
In that cemetery.
So that's a good segue into some things that we do at the Bureau with the Civil War trails, and you know, other. We get a lot of requests for people wanting to come in to see some of the sites where we may have soldiers or slaves buried that have been part of all the different eras of wars that have been going on throughout, you know, since the Revolutionary War. So that's good to know because I didn't know that.
I don't know about any slaves buried there, but we have, I think it's 17 Revolutionary War soldiers. And there is an individual, a volunteer, who spent hours working on straightening stones and getting rid of some vegetation that shouldn't be there. And he's by next year, we hope to have the records revised, that they're more up-to-date, mm-hmm. more accurate than they were in the past. So
what's really interesting is, and I think sometimes we all forget, there's a lot of history that is here in our county, mm-hmm. and we forget things like that we did have people that participated in like the Revolutionary War, the Civil War, that are laid to rest right here. And people are very interested in coming to the area to see that. But from a local perspective, I think it's something that we need to acknowledge and come out and view and understand what's happened in our county, what people did to make sure that our country was safe.
People are more and more involved in genealogy, too. So they do a lot of tracing back their family history and would come to a cemetery such as the one here. But it's obviously a labor of love for someone to care and maintain cemeteries that are from the 1700s. Mm-hmm.
This particular individual who's working on the cemetery does have relatives buried on that mm-hmm. cemetery, and he has time now. He's retired, and he's always had an interest in genealogy.
Yeah, that's very good.
He's doing in that. So we're working at it, and hope to see a lot of people on the 1st and 2nd of November.
Now, just to clarify, you have the event, the bazaar, every year.
The bazaar is every year, yes.
But you're heightening because it's 200 years next year.
Two years. Well, basically, we're
going to add to it in 2 years.
I don't know about that. Okay. I don't know that. I can't answer that. I don't know. But the church has normal services in the Sunday, in the summer. There are two regular church services there, morning services. We have a hymn sing the last Saturday in April, and we also have a Pennsylvania German service the last Saturday in September. And then we have weddings. We have a number of weddings scheduled for next year. And a lot of people from out of the area. We've had individuals from the state, from Washington, D.C., Virginia, considerable distance coming there mm-hmm. just to have their wedding there.
Which is really
we had some rather
terrific.
Large weddings there. We've had about we had one wedding that had not quite 350 people in the church.
Wow, was
that's the largest one that I'm familiar
standing
with.
Standing room only.
Yeah,
not quite. No, everyone was seated. There's room. It doesn't appear to be that large, but mm-hmm. it is. And the one thing I'm going to get into on the tour. I'm not going to mention it here. I'm just going to put a teaser out. Old Belleman's Church was involved in financing the Second World War on the Axis side. I'll just get into that. On the tour, I'll mention how we helped. And it wouldn't be Germany, even though we are an old German congregation. It was through the Italians.
Wow.
So that'll
you'll
be on the tour.
You'll tell us more on the tour.
Yeah. Right.
All right. Well, we look forward to that. And if there's anything else that comes to mind, I'll come back to you at the end of the program and say, hey, John, what else? What did you miss? So,
thank you, John.
Yeah, very interesting. And you know, it's great that we have individuals like yourself who still look to take care of our history here in the county. So,
you have younger parishioners who are stepping in and taking over some of the older guard?
There are some, yes, there are some. There are some people stepping in. And we also... 2 years ago, I started offering a Pennsylvania German course. In other words, at the church. We meet every Tuesday evening. Usually not in the summertime, but we're meeting right now. Every Tuesday evening, 7 to 9 we meet.
Wow. So you're fluent in Pennsylvania Dutch?
He can't claim any Pennsylvanian Dutch, Schwed.
I was going to say you could sign off for us at the end of the program.
Yeah, maybe we'll have you do that.
If we get Big John Ulrich to call in, maybe we can have a conversation.
I just know, all I know is my grandfather was Hinkle, Pennsylvania Dutch, and I know Schleck and Haley Hinkleschick. There was some kind of
Hinkle direct.
He did some kind of thing over your warts and things to get rid of them and heal you. So. Well, thank you so much. Dan, so welcome from Crystal Cave.
Oh, thank you.
We'll get to you in a few seconds. I think we're up for a break. Okay. We'll come back and you can tell us all about the Ghost Lantern Tour and the regular historical lantern tours that happened there at Crystal Cave this weekend.
Okay.
You're watching bctv.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For other stories and information, go to bctv.org.
We're busy chatting here.
I know. We're having too much fun. So welcome back. We're back, and now we're going to have a conversation with Dan Schaffer of Crystal Cave. And Dan, you got some really cool stuff happening there this weekend.
We do.
And I know you're a big part of it. Maybe you can tell us a little bit about the Ghost Lantern Tours, which I know are historical in nature, but as well for the holiday of Halloween, a little bit spiritual.
If you've been to Crystal Cave and you've taken a traditional tour that has history included in it, but it also deals more of the aspects of science, how what's in the cave and how things form. Mm-hmm. But the lantern tours are an idea that they started a few years back. They're given in July and August and then again in October. And these tours are based on what the original guides did when the cave opened up in 1872. Hmm. And they actually go back to what they had in their journals and the things that they did with the tourists as they took them through. And a lot of the information came from the local newspapers and publications. There's an age limit on that. We don't like to have anyone that's not 8 years old, because you're going through with a lantern, the lights are off, the guides are in the garb from the gilded time period, the ladies and the gents as well. But then for October, what they also do is they put in a haunted portion. Right. So it's not the haunted barn or the haunted forest, but rather, once again, it's historical in nature. So what comes to be, any of the groups that I have when I go in, and you're standing in an area where there's a 60 to 80 foot drop off, and you go back to where they dealt with the guides dealt with their people, and they're actually tied together in groups to take through. They wore their best clothes as they went through during that time period. Mm-hmm. And they used ladders to bridge the gaps between rocks that had fallen from the ceiling. It's hard to imagine that nobody fell to their death.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So,
especially if they were all tied together, that could be really dangerous.
Yeah, well, one guy, it's like the lemmings, you all follow them along. But, you know, I do look at it as being recorded, and recorded that, so you put that any way you like. However, the haunted portion goes along with individuals not who died in the cave, but rather on the compound itself and some of the other buildings.
Oh.
Okay? And because of the fact that those are true stories, accountable as best that history will give it to us, that's another reason why we have the age limit there, because they're very mm-hmm. unusual.
Oh.
Okay, so we point that out to the individuals, and we have gone to the point where some have actually had experiences while they're there.
Wow.
I never have, but some have, and the way of television anymore is for the reality shows. So
right.
the management had gone and they brought in a paranormal group.
Oh, wow.
Who has actually went through all the buildings where people have experienced things, employees and tourists alike, and they conversed. they talk, and we also bring that information up and we relay that on the tour as well. Okay. So it's nice that, that there's a factual base, but it's also an open-ended because it lets you go mm-hmm. with your imagination right. wherever you like to go.
Right, and you don't know what you might experience
you do not.
While you're there.
No, you do not.
Now, one thing I asked you a little earlier, and I think we should share with our audience, is that it's cold outside, but it may not be too cold in the cave.
Cave is absolutely great. In those summer months when you have 90 plus degrees and the humidities are 80% and higher, it's the perfect air conditioner. You go in during the winter or you go in during this time period, it feels warmer because the cave temperatures are relatively uniform. They're going to be in the mid-50s from front to back. Each of the rooms might vary a little bit, but essentially if I tell you it's 54, 55 degrees, it is.
Gotcha.
And that's nice.
Yeah.
So Crystal Cave was open for commercial use in 1872. Was it discovered prior to that?
It was by accident. That was it still is farmland, and that was the Merkel farmland at the time. And along with the Garretts finding limestone to use in the farming practice, mm-hmm. blasting a hillside, they exposed the cave. And then it was leased and then to buy by the Kohlers from the Kutztown area.
Is it unusual for a cave of this type to be like a one-off just in one location, or in other areas where there's caves that are multiple numbers? It just kind of seems a little unusual out there by itself.
Typically caves are not alone, and there are a few other mm-hmm. caves in that area. So from our Kutztown address, Virginville has Onyx Cave, and then there's a Schaffer's Cave. There's some other smaller ones. Mm-hmm. Richmond Township has a small little cave there. And it all goes how the limestone is laying, how the water will percolate through, and how the caverns will form. There's no very large caves around here, again, because of the size of those, but no connections have been found between those caves.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. That's interesting.
It is interesting because they're a short distance.
Yeah. You know, one other question I had was, I know that the events are happening today, tonight and tomorrow night, but you shared with me that you may add a few based on the number of people that see this today.
To see this, if you're interested in coming to the tours, the last two are scheduled now for tonight, the 25th, and tomorrow, the 26th. They start at 5:30, but you need to make reservations ahead of time. Mm-hmm. You can do that by calling on their phone, 610-683-6765, or going to their website, www.crystalkpa.com. But management has indicated that if there is enough interest, and Halloween is still next week, mm-hmm. that they would continue, they would consider opening up and booking for the following weekend as
that's
well.
Good.
Okay,
so
that
does it normally close down? Is it normally then closed down after Halloween?
No, the months that it's closed are, it's going to be closed from December through February.
Okay.
Okay, the rest of the year it's open. And that's actually a great prelude to come to see that original tour first, mm-hmm. the standard tour, and then take the historical one afterwards, because it's almost as if you're in two different places.
Yeah, that's very interesting. Very interesting.
So the question everyone in Berks County has, was Crystal Cave named after Crystal? Was Crystal named after Crystal Cave?
I'm that's hoping it's
first.
The other way around.
That is one of the things you're going to find out on that tour.
Okay.
I don't know. My mother said I had a sparkle in my eye when I was born, so that's how I got the name. Well, there's great information. There's so many other things to do.
Absolutely.
In the next couple weeks, you know, I always say this, don't tell me there's nothing to do in Berks uh-huh. County, because there's a lot going on. And, you know, it's interesting. I know Kevin and I, our hope is to go out and behind the scenes for you at some point mm-hmm. to see really how all these
things
get
work.
Put together
right.
and how they work. But, you know, it's really interesting when you go, ask the questions and try to understand how did this start? How did you get involved, the individual working it, like John or Dan? How do I volunteer if you want to volunteer and be part of it? Because there's a lot of opportunity out there for all of us as Berks Countyans to get involved in things and help to grow what we have here, but to also learn more about our history.
And I believe the visitors see a lot more than we do, because we live here, we work here, and
very
we don't
true.
See the beauty and the history here, as was pointed out here this morning. We have to do a better job of educating ourselves.
Right.
And I think if you look at publications, the Visitors Bureau website, everything that's going on, you could literally, for a Halloween-type themed tradition. You could start on October 1 and not see everything through October 31st. There's just so much that goes on in this great county that you just can't get to everything.
No.
And some are free, some are moderately priced, but I think it's really, all of it's geared, with one exception, to family entertainment.
Right.
And that's really what we're all about in Around Berks County, is to get out there and recognize the things that are great for Berks Countyans and their families, because we want them to stay here and grow here and really just bring a higher level of entertainment and tourism to this great community. Quality of life, absolutely.
Yeah. And with that said, I think we have a lot of other things that we can mention.
I think we do.
All right. So
we could run out of time.
I know. Well, you know, this weekend, what's happening in Hamburg?
The King Frost Parade.
Yeah, the 50th annual.
50th.
King, this is a quiz. It's trivia.
Yes. It was recreated after many years. I guess it was there was an original King Frost Parade, and it was put by the wayside for years. It came back after the war, right?
I don't know. It's a good
after
question.
1964.
John, you know.
1964.
So it's been around 65. For a long time. I know it's well attended. Mm-hmm. It's one of the larger parades, I think, actually, in the state that goes on. And if you have children, it's great because a lot of Halloween costumes, a lot of fun there. But then you also have a lot of the holiday, the Christmas holiday going on. And we have King Frost. Who doesn't want to see King Frost?
That's right.
I know. And you go out, you sit on the curb, you get your blanket, you wrap up, you get hot chocolate, and you're happy.
Hot chocolate or something else.
Right. You're happy. Yeah, right. It depends. There's also at RCP Theaters, the Reading Community Player Theaters, this weekend, there's Little Shop of Horrors, which I heard is going really well. And if you want to get out and see a musical, they have Friday and Saturday night, and Sunday they have it going on, so all's good there. Mountain by Moonlight, South Y Camp.
Mountain by Moonlight.
Mountain by Moonlight has the return of the haunted hayride. So, yeah, we have a cave, we have the mountain, and that's a really family-oriented program. You can come with your flashlights and do some great a hayride and some other great things up there with the family for the Halloween.
Is that do they do that every year, or is that something new to South Mountain?
As far as I know, they do something, but the haunted hayride is new for them. Mm-hmm. Again. It's returning. It hasn't been there for a while, so it's back. Mysterious Melancholy and Anyway, Effort of Cloister. they have experience for you to go through. They're in the cemetery. They're talking about some of the mysterious things that happen up at the cloister. You'll learn about the history, but you also get to experience weird things that go on as you go through the cemetery there. And I think it's different, a lot of fun. And remember, Ephrata, it's not in Berks County, but it's really only another 15-minute ride up the road. And it's a quaint little town. It has the charm of Berks County, mm-hmm. and that's what I like about it.
I think that's macabre, isn't it?
Macabre, is that how you say it?
I got
macabre.
It. You have to give me a minute or two and I can figure out. I've phonetically spread out the word there. I can figure that out.
It's that R-E at the end.
Melancholy and macabre.
Macabre.
I get tripped up on letters that you should pronounce, but you don't have to.
Oh, okay. Yes. Well, I did too, obviously. I'm trying to pronounce them and they're not making sense.
That's okay.
You know, I know we also have Ghost Stories by Charlie Adams at Morlotten Village.
He's back, huh?
He's back.
He's only partially retired.
That's right.
Okay.
That's right.
Retired,
you know,
from his paying job.
Charlie, as soon as we're over the Halloween happenings everywhere, Charlie's going to be working with our bureau a little bit to develop some more haunted itineraries and programs, but also to work on some other programs about the railroads that we have here. A lot of visitors come in and want to know more about the railroads and what happened here during those time periods. Mm-hmm. So he's going to be doing a little writing for us, which is great, and I'm so appreciative of it. There's also Daniel Boone Homestead has hauntings going on. And, you know, it's a lot of fun down there. It probably is really eerie, and I want to see what time it goes. It's noon to 4, and it's for your children. They have ghost monsters.
Does Daniel Boone come back?
Goblins. No, it doesn't say that. But they're doing some demonstrations on blacksmithing and all other kinds of textiles that they process down there. So that should be fun.
Certainly,
and you get to
yeah.
go in the Boone House and the Bertolt Log House and visit that. So
certainly avail yourself of everything there is to offer here in Berks County.
Yes.
At least for the month of October into early November. Then we're going to swing right into the Santa Claus Parade, the downtown Christmas Parade, November 23rd. So swinging right from Halloween right into Thanksgiving slash getting ready for
coming.
Christmas.
Yeah,
I think they
really
were putting candy
quick.
Out in the stores and Christmas decorations
already.
Out at Labor Day.
Yeah.
So we're fast tracking right through to the holidays.
Yeah.
And if John would like to sign off for us in Pennsylvania Dutch, around Berks County, we'll be back in November.
Yes.
Well, ich will hoffe, dass alle paar BCT watchen durch auf ihre Guckboxe.
There you go. That was
Thank
better than
John.
We could have said.
Thank you so much.
Have a great day. Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen.